It's the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. The Sports Hit List presents Smoking Mirrors with Declan Krogman and the Polius Brothers, Greg and Stefan, breaking down the biggest news in sports, giving you the stories behind the story, here for all the smoke, all the time, right here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
Welcome to Smoke and Mirrors here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. I'm your host, Declan Krogman, alongside Steph and Greg Polius. Greg, Steph Polius, whatever you want to call them. Greg and Stephen Polius, the Polius Brothers, right here on the Worldwide Sports
that
Radio
works
Network.
Too, man.
Steph, it's like Steph Curry, the three-point champion, which is a great segue to get into All-Star Weekend. Before I say, this is Smoke and Mirrors, presented by the one and only Sports Hit List. So here we go. We can get right into I don't want to say the best news of the weekend, but I guess the most exciting news of the weekend, which was All-Star Weekend last night, or All-Star Day.
Yeah, All-Star Day, right? The formatting change was rather interesting. I know Greg and I were talking about it. He really likes it. I like it as well, kind of just like having it all in. Did not watch the three-point shooting contest live, but I saw the highlights. Dunk contest I did, though. I thought the first half of that was fun, that first round. Second round, but that final to me was just really weak. I'm gonna personally go ahead and say that my favorite dunk was gonna be why am I blanking on the name right now? Anfernee Simon, that first dunk, that like 12 feet grabs about the basketball off like what's 12 feet up.
Yeah,
just,
Portland.
Like slams it down. It was just impressive. It was an impressive feat at 6'3". The kid just has bungees. It's amazing. But yeah, overall, I thought it was okay. That to me was better. I did like it all in the one night.
I mean, yeah, I would say I kind of like the two-day format because, you know, Saturday night, I feel like it's so marquee, All-Star Weekend, especially when they did it, in New York when they, you know, switched out between MSG and the Barclays Center. I like the three-point contest and dunk contest. Skills challenge, I don't really care. You could do that whenever or not at all. It doesn't mean much to me. But the dunk contest and the three-point contest, I do like on Saturday night. But it worked. It did. I mean, it catered to the audience. I'm not sure what the ratings were, but I think it worked.
I don't think it's great for, you know, the networks, right? There's less airtime. There's less advertisement space. So it's not great for the networks. I mean, yeah, you can make it into a whole weekend, and I think it's fun. But sometimes it feels drawn out, right? Because, like, okay, like you have the three events, and then you have the All-Star game. But I like it neatly packaged, to be honest with you. It's, you know, yeah. If it was on the Saturday and my Sunday was spent doing something else, like that's efficient.
Yeah.
Hey, guys. Also, I would like to thank Stefan's Friday attire for inspiring my Monday attire since the sun is shining. You know, I decided to put on a little nice little summertime button up.
Hey, weather's getting warmer. It's going to be like 60 degrees this week. We got to hit the field.
Weather's coming.
We got to hit the field.
But that whole while I did enjoy the format of all happening in one day, whole thing was trash. Trash. The game was trash. Slam dunk contest was trash. Three-point contest didn't even have the defending champ in it. Yeah, it was all trash. Trash. Big trash.
So the whole dunk contest was trash? Come on.
In comparison, there was only three dunks that I really liked in the entire thing. It was Obi Toppin jumping over his windmill. Pops and Julius Randle with the one-handed windmill. Cassius Stanley, who got robbed on his first dunk.
He 100% did. He got an 8. He got an 8.
Wow. And Anthony
gave it a 9.
And Anthony Simon dunk that you praised. Like, he made it look easy. So, like you said, it seems like he got jerked because he made it look so easy. But what I think we're missing here is that All-Star Weekend in terms of the two-day format is more about what happens off the court than what happens on the court. The events, the red carpet events, pageantry. And things that the pageantry about All-Star Weekend. that's what sells. That's what really sells in particular cities. It's like an economy boost almost. But as far as what's happening on the court, I could do without it. I'd rather just have it in one day.
All right. I mean, that makes sense. Now, do you think that Obi Toppin got robbed?
No, I think Cassius Stanley got robbed.
Ooh.
Agree with I think that.
Draymond Green had a quote. He said the first dunk, he was like, Stanley got robbed. And then the second one, he said that he robbed himself.
Yeah, it wasn't a great dunk. I mean, he ended up with like 3 sevens and like 2 eights or something like that. It wasn't a great dunk. But I also felt like Anthony Simon's second dunk wasn't anything special too, and he got a couple tens. You know, like he showed his athleticism, which I think is good. But Obi Toppin to me was like him dunking over Julius Randle and his pops on the windmill was impressive.
I don't think they appreciated that.
I mean, I don't know. They didn't appreciate it. Sticking on. Oh, go ahead, Steph.
I was gonna say that third dunk though, when Anthony Simon he almost kissed the rim. I mean, he didn't really kiss it. He like got close and then like jerked back.
I feel like he would gave himself whiplash if he kissed the rim.
Yeah, no, bro, commit. Like, I wanted him to do that, hit his head, and then like dunk it still. Cause like, commit to it. He won off that. Like, it was just like, to me, the ending was weak. I enjoyed the dunks earlier, but like that end, like when he grabbed the trophy, I was like, oh, that's it. That's the dunk that did it. You know, it was very anticlimactic. So now, I just thought the end was bad. It was entertaining. Looking at the highlights from the 3-point shooting contest, it was fun.
Watching came down Steph to the last money ball.
I mean, yeah, it came out to the last money ball. But I feel like there's something to be said for not having the defending champ there. Like, I think that would have made it a little more enticing, intriguing to watch.
I agree.
Also, the game itself, I lost interest in the game in the first 5 minutes.
I didn't even turn it on.
Carl said the game was trash because KD can't draft. We need to talk about that.
Bro, what did I tell you? You were sitting there in the kitchen. You talking about, oh, nah, I'm team KD. He has a chance. He drafted a better team.
Listen, Smoke. If KD Smoke. Played, it's a different story. That's all I'm saying.
All right, all I'm going to say is I did see a little stat that Giannis had he made all 16 of his shots, which impressive. I don't care what you say about it. Like, that's a fun little, you know, factoid to throw in there. Otherwise, very forgettable.
The entire game.
Getting into the comments quickly, someone said, I thought it was at 1:30. Well, we got the marquee debate event at 1:30. Smoke and Mirrors is from 1 to 2, Mondays and Fridays, every week. So we got the debate coming in at 1:30. For our listeners who haven't heard, Andres Rivas, Anthony Mullen are going to take on Greg and Stephan Polias on a debate on whether momentum exists in sports. Momentum, facts, or fiction. And I'll be doing my best Carl Coulange impression, trying to moderate this one.
Wait. I'm reading the comment section live, and somebody just said Steph should have won MVP. How do you not give Giannis MVP after going 16 for 16, 3 for 3 from 3, and 35 points? How does he not get MVP?
Here's what I'll say about Giannis. Like, this guy could do anything. That's just proof that Giannis will always get slandered.
That's crazy. I'm going to agree with that, because there should be no question. If someone made every shot, not like they took 2 shots or 3 shots, it took 16 shots and made every one of them and made everything from 3 when he's not even a 3-point shooter like that. And we're not going to give it to him? 35 points? Come on.
What more do you do?
What more can he do? I don't know. What else you want from a man that makes every shot? I personally, I don't know who made that comment, but shame on you. Whoever it is, shame on you.
Coming in hot. Sean Kiernan said, hold on. Sean Kiernan said, what were your thoughts on having only 3 participants? I wanted more people involved in the dunk contest. I agree.
Oh, I agree with him.
100% it's usually 4.
Yeah.
Greg and I were talking. Rookies. I'm like,
It's always been all rookies. I'm saying 4 rookies.
Like, yeah.
Nah, it's never been all rookies. It's been a little bit of a mix.
I feel like recently it's been rookies or younger players.
Yeah, well, because that's their chance to really shine. A lot of the veterans are like, you know, they had their fun. Zach LaVine didn't want to do it this year. I would have loved to see Zach.
He's one of the best dunkers in the game. So I know he's obviously not, you know, not a 7-footer, but it doesn't matter in dunk contest.
I'm gonna go on record. What? What are you going to say, Greg? You go first.
It's not me. It's the follow-up to the Giannis comment.
All right, hold on. Before we get there. No. Wait. Before we get there, because it's all about the dunk contest, I will say low-key MVP for that dunk contest was Kenny, because that man is hilarious. Bro, his commentary kept all the energy. Everything better. Because he was right on most of what he was saying, right? You know what I'm saying? It was, as far as the like Stanley getting eight on his first dunk, like that was just ridiculous. It's really rude. You know, he kept it entertaining. Like to me, that commentary kept me engaged, you know, throughout the dunk contest. But I agree, it should have been more than three. You know, having the three rookies there is nice, but like it just needed that fourth or fifth person to really spice it up. Because it went by so quickly. Like I blinked and it was over.
Yeah. Well, maybe that was by design because it was at halftime. They cut it down to three, but I think the four is so traditional. It works.
Four would be fine. Four sounds like it really balances it out.
Saki Steph, that's what we call you.
Oh, my God. It's not even 1:15 yet.
My Cheers, God. Bro. Cheers. Oh,
bro. Deck, I'm sorry, man. Like,
yeah. Deck, you got 3 years, bro.
This is kind of
years. This is how I do my show. This is how I do my show with style.
All right, this is like when Marshawn Lynch told Peyton Manning that he takes a shot of Hennessy before every game. This is exactly what this is right now.
We all have our methods. Marty likes a shot of water before we start a show. That's what I get.
We're not going to get into Marty. Oh my God. Moving on to some more basketball before our first commercial break.
Wait, sorry. Before we get to the commercial break, I just want to hear that response to that comment you were talking about.
He said, NC said, every NC. Shot. Yeah. Every shot when not much D played. So he's basically saying, yeah, it's easy to go 16 for 16.
All right.
I mean, if that's the case, NC, more people in this game would have shot up 100% from the field.
Where are the other people at 100%? There was no one else. You act like only no one was guarding Giannis. That was it. It was like Giannis open shots all day. Come on, man. NC, looking at you.
All right. You know what? Like, here's the
come harder next time.
Here's my thing with the All-Star games, right? Like at this point. In 2021, where not even the fact that they almost didn't have an All-Star game because of COVID, but just All-Star games in general, even last year pre-COVID, if you're not kind of tuned into the fact that there's going to be no defense whatsoever, besides maybe a nice block for fans, a risky block that a guy tries hard, and that goes for all sports, there's going to be no defense. The Pro Bowl is a glorified touch game. Nobody cares.
Wait. I do not agree with that. MLB All-Star game is the most competitive All-Star game out of all major sports.
Did I mention the All-Star game, though?
He did not.
I'm not talking.
But you said all All-Star games. That's why I had to make
sure. You did say that.
Thanks. Got my back for 1 second. I was getting to that.
Well, you were wrong. When you're right, you're right. When you're wrong, you're wrong. I'm here for you when you're right. But when you're wrong, I'm over here.
What am I wrong about that? Of course, the MLB All-Star game is competitive, you know, obviously, but defensively, there's a different defense in baseball. First of all, the defense controls the ball in baseball. And the Pro Bowl and NBA defense, you know, going laterally, that's different. Or vertically, excuse me.
Yeah.
You know what? Let's get into commercial break. We could talk about all-star defense or lack thereof for hours. No, we can't. Actually, nobody cares. You're listening to Smoke and Mirrors here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network, presented by the Sports Hit List. I'm your host, Declan Crogan, alongside Greg and Stephen Polius. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
It's the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. This is Smoke and Mirrors on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
Welcome back to Smoke and Mirrors here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. I'm Declan Crogman alongside Greg and Stephen Polius, here presented by the Sports Hit List, the one and only Carl Coulange. Shout out to the CEO. The CEO is Errol Marks. Shout out to the Don of the Sports Hit List. We got a nice little segment here before we head into our debate around 1:30. But right now, let's get into Greg and Steph's favorite sport, my favorite sport in the spring and the summer.
You're so wishy-washy when it comes to that.
Yeah. Do we need to talk about that? Like, I am full football. Like, let's play football. Once, like, you know, August hits, I'm like, all right, full football. And then once March hits, it's full baseball. But there's, like, no in-between, you know? Except last year when the draft came in quarantine, I was like, oh, I'm going to get back into football. Like, I'm excited. But, yeah, it's literally a two-sport athlete seasonal thing, and it's so annoying. I hate it so much. It's like having two girlfriends. Not that I would ever know that. anyway. Nice. Yeah, right? You got to let them know. No, I'm not like that.
She's not listening.
No. Anyway, contrary to what Deb may encourage me to involve.
So
in the baseball. Yeah, go ahead, Greg.
Yeah. So last Friday, we ended the show kind of talking about Marcus Stroman, and you and Chuck. Well, Chuck was in the comments, but you guys had issues with his Twitter fingers and some of the things that he would say on social media.
Can I just preface that for a sec?
Go ahead.
I'm sorry. Like, I love Marcus Stroman. He's one of my favorite pitchers in the league. I think he's so electric. And I also love the fact that he's 5'7" and he walked on like he's 6'4". I love that. So, but mm-hmm. Go ahead.
But, I felt a butt coming around. You felt the step, didn't you?
No, I didn't have a butt coming. Not at all. I was ready.
He needed to preface your comments because he feels like he's about to be slandered. That's exactly what just took place.
I mean, I'm not about to be slandered. But
you don't know what that man's about to do. He has all the power when he speaks.
That's true. I mean, that's definitely the teacher in him. But I'm excited to see what you have to say. But go ahead.
And there's, I would say, a lot of Yankee fans take issue with Marcus Stroman because they feel like, in their eyes, he always has the Yankees' name in his mouth. And to defend him, when a reporter asks a question, I think it's kind of crazy that we as fans get upset when a player answers truthfully, but then we also get upset when they give the company line. So why are Yankee fans really upset with Marcus Stroman?
That's a great question. Listen, I, as a Yankee fan, I can't speak for all Yankee fans, obviously. I'm not upset with Marcus Stroman for mentioning the Yankees. However, I will say this. When a question is asked, what do you like most about either if you're happy to be home pitching in New York or if you're happy to be pitching for the Mets, what does that have to do with I never wanted to go to the Yankees? I don't have an issue with it. It just doesn't make sense to me. If you see an inside track here, I would love to hear.
You remember that, like, 20 seconds ago when you just said preface, when you wanted to preface something? So what Marcus Stroman was doing was prefacing an article that was written about him prior to the trade stating how he wanted to – it was a false report. So he was letting them know that, hey, this was a false report. You are the same people that are in this media room asking me these questions, but you then wrote lies about me. So here I'm correcting the record. And Yankee fans got all butt hurt. It's especially Manny and Chuck, you guys, yep. Especially
trying to find it right now.
Well, like, Manny's why he always got the Yankees name in his mouth? Like,
but in all fairness, when was this trade?
What was this? 2 years? Because he didn't play last season. He didn't play last season.
July of 2019, right at the deadline. Yeah. Right? And now, when did he say this? When was this quote?
This was, I think, media, like his media day before this season started.
Not even a month ago. So we're talking about something from July 2019, and we're referencing it spring training of 2021 when you got a new owner, a new shortstop. You didn't play last year, and now we're going to talk about this. It just seems unnecessary.
So who are you to say?
How do we know those people are in the mood? Who are you to tell him
how to express himself?
I'm not telling him how to express himself.
But I mean, that's what it sounds like.
Who are you to defend him? We're all talking about how. Go ahead.
Because he's being slandered by Yankee fans for answering a question.
First of all, it's not a false report. He 100%. There were reports that he threw a tantrum in the Toronto locker room.
Go ahead, Steph. You got this because I read the article and there was no tangible evidence of anything.
Well, the one that you referenced in the chat that you and several other Yankee fans referenced in the chat was a TMZ Sports article that said that Stroman wanted to go to the Yankees, and all the reporter did was run him down. The article is a stretch, but that's what all of you used as the reference, as you know, Marcus Stroman saying he wanted to go to the Yankees. All the reporter said is, hey, would you like to go to the Yankees? And he said something, it was offhand, I forget the exact term, but he never said yes.
I'm excited to pitch for the Blue Jays, but he was saying something like
it was very like vanilla, you know, neutral. It didn't lean anyone any which way, but when you looked at the headline, it said Marcus Stroman says he wants to go to the Yankees, or he'd like to pitch for the Yankees, and he never said that, because what's in quotes did not say I would like to pitch for the Yankees, and that was being used in that group chat, and I'm sure amongst other Yankee fans, saying that, oh well, he's still thinking about us because we didn't get him during the trade deadline. I just think that Stroman is just like any player. You hear, like, we're not hearing as much as they hear because they live their own lives, and everything that comes up, like, sometimes players are looking at Twitter. Like, I think Steph Curry, it was a report that he looks at Twitter sometimes. He looks at social media
halftime
during a game. Yeah, halftime. Players are looking at their mentions, bro. Like, you look at one report, but they're getting everything about them. So I'm sure Marcus Stroman's seen Yankee fans talking about him. And when a reporter asks him a question and it's adjacent, he'll bring it up. Why wouldn't you? It's human nature to do that. It's like, well, I need to clear the air. Because to me, it's clearing the air. There's a misconception with players very often because the media does spin narratives. We all know that. This show is kind of it's born in that. Oh, that man. There's a bunch of spin happening out in the media. So I'm just saying it's not outlandish for Marcus Stroman to be bringing up that the Yankee past when it's very much present, when everyone's mentioning it still as Yankee fans and talking.
People were mentioning it,
especially when he didn't play last year. You left that out. The fact that he didn't play, he wasn't a part of any media days
I said he didn't play last year.
Manny's in the comments hopping around like a angry lawn gnome.
No, I'm sorry,
I was disrespectful. Manny, yeah. Manny, we cool. I got your back. Greg, calm down. Like, you good. I got you, Manny.
You know what? I gotta say something to Manny now. He's walking it back like a Michael Jackson moonwalk. I'm not appreciating this. Saying I'm the one who kept running my no, I just told you I love Stroman. He's a Long Island kid. I told you why I like Stroman.
I think he's talking about in the chat where you were peddling that article hard.
I was saying, okay, like the idea that he didn't want to go to the Yankees, I don't consider that debunked. I think, of course, he would want to go to the Yankees. Like, he's coming home to New York. Greg, I know you actually hate the Yankees. I'm going to ask Steph instead. If you're a big league player, I know you have your beef and it's warranted. But, yeah. Steph, if you're a big league player and you're playing in Toronto, right, all your family's in New York. You're hearing your name move. You're hearing your name in some rumors at the trade deadline. You wouldn't want to go to the Yankees to come home?
Well, that really depends on, like, for me personally, I would want the best opportunity. And I'm sure that's how Stroman was taking it. He didn't approach, like I said, Stroman didn't approach it as I'm against the Yankees. He was being neutral, as any player should. You know, because if I was leaning against a team and that's the team that wanted me the most, and I just lost out on opportunity, why would I do that? They're a winning team. So I think he did exactly what he needed to do and was very diplomatic about it. But you have fandom that doesn't care about diplomacy. So anything could be twisted. Any narrative could be twisted. That TMZ sports article was referenced because it gave Yankee fans energy. It fired them up. Yeah, he wanted to be a Yankee.
He was in New York, too, I think.
He was in New York at the time, but he's still a Blue Jay. So they were talking about the potential. But what I'm saying is that the fan base, anything can like motivate them to get a hype. And that was it. That soundbite was enough.
So that was a puff piece, you think? That was a puff piece.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely. 100%. 100%. And before we go on break, big Ed Gonzalez, you're wilding, bro. Stroman is not a bum. Yeah. Stop it.
Is everybody wilding in the chat? I'm not in the chat, bro. Y'all need to calm down. I'm just going to say it from here. From a person on the outside looking in, chill out. All right? Y'all doing a lot right now.
I'm waiting for them to reference Aaron Judge's home runs against them. But I'm just – it's just whatever.
Manny literally just did it. Literally, as you said that.
You got to be kidding me. That's insane.
And on Aaron Judge will hit a home run bomb.
Oh my commercial God. Break, baby.
That's insane. Let's hit the commercial. We got the big debate up next. Stro Show coming to New York for a first time full season. So let's see how it turns out. Steph is telling Manny he can catch the hands. Oh, I'm instigating. Already in moderator mode. Here we go. All right, guys. Commercial break. Smoke and mirrors here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. Don't go anywhere. Debate's next. Andres Rivas, Anthony Molina here. Stick around. We'll be right back.
It's the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. This is Smoke and Mirrors on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
Welcome to Smoke and Mirrors here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. Declan Krogman alongside Greg and Stefan Polias. Anthony Mullen and Andres Rivas in the building. Anthony can hear. He's got some nice signs in the background.
Some technical difficulties, I think, on his part.
yeah, maybe try to plug in some headphones. In the meantime, the marquee event is finally here. I can't believe it. We kind of got that going. Anthony's going to join back. We'll be right back. We just have a little bit of technical difficulties with him, but he'll be right back. Andres, Mr. Numbers, you're here. I'll give you a formal introduction in a sec. I'm just going to kind of preface the entire debate as Anthony jumps back in. Let us know if we can hear it or jumps out, whatever he just did. All right, so we got the biggest debate, the first debate in Smoke and Mirrors history, presented by the Sports Hit List. We got momentum in sports. All right, like I said, I'll be doing my best Carl Kalani impression. I'm not going to go in full Chris Wallace, you know, welcome, you know, whatever. We're not going to do that. So we're excited here. All right, Anthony, are you good?
Yeah, I'm good. I just couldn't get my headphones to work, but I don't know if this how the sound is going to work.
You sound fine. It's all good.
Sound good, bro.
Okay.
All right. So it is now 1:32 on Monday, March 8th. We're 2 minutes behind schedule. That's fine. It doesn't matter. Falco comes on Friday. He's on. He's we're good. All right. All right. Here we go. Let's start with Andre since he is the challenger, and then we'll head over to Steph. Although he's on the opposite side, we're going to go, you know, mix and match here. And then we'll get to Anthony and then Greg. Andres. Introducing Andres Rivas. He is a Heat fan who claims to be from Miami.
Yo, the joke's not flying with me, bro. The jokes are not flying with me, bro.
All right, he's not with the jokes, but that just means I'm going to keep doing it. He does have a 305 area code. Whether he bought that phone number, I don't know. I cannot confirm. All right, on the team for momentum, drinking his sake, as always, next to his plant named Marty, I think. It's Stefan Polias, rocking the gold chain today. Back down to the team against momentum. It's the Laker fan who I think is from Brooklyn, at least New York.
Bed-Stuy to be exact.
I'll give you that. So he's a Laker fan who is not a fan of the Bed-Stuy Nets uniforms from last season. From Bed-Stuy.
Of course I am.
He is a fan. Here we go. Anthony Mullen is in the building making his debut on Smoke and Mirrors. You guys are the first guests we have, which is awesome.
Thank you.
I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
I know. You guys – I'd be honored. Honestly, this is great. All right.
Jack,
so now
can I say one thing real quick?
Go ahead, man. What's up?
Real quick. Okay. So I'm not a Mets fan or a Yankees fan. Eddie just called Marcus Stroman a bum. Marcus Stroman ranked third in ground ball percentage. Like he was a ground ball pitcher. The Mets had like 30 something errors 2 years ago, but that was because of Pete Alonso and Todd Frazier. Now they have Pete Alonso, Jeff McNeil, Francisco Lindor, and JD Davis. So at least be unbiased when talking about Marcus Stroman.
In all fairness, Jeff McNeil did have three errors yesterday. But we can talk about the Mets defensive.
Nobody cares about spring training. Those stats don't count.
Nobody cares about spring training, but they were in the same glove. And
we're straying away from
let's get back to the topic. All right. Introducing Greg to round out the no momentum team. It would have been nice to have some Schmurt in the back.
Thank you, Michael Buffer.
All right, there we go. Momentum for Greg Polias is a thing, as you well know by his baseball career, which he loves to talk about so much, and we love to listen. So anyway, listen. That was a compliment, all right? That wasn't even shade.
It was shade.
It was a little shady.
I'm not Cleo. It wasn't supposed
to be
shady.
You cleaned it up at the end, but it was a little shady in the beginning.
Yeah, I cleaned it up for I've been breaking everybody's balls today. This is just how it goes. All right. Let's start off. We're going to have some opening statements from Andres and Anthony. Here we go. Andres, you can go first. Anthony, you go second. We want to know why you guys think – what's up?
No, go ahead.
All right. We want
to
know why
we're going to prove why there's no such thing as momentum in sports. Go ahead.
Can't wait to hear it. Andres, take it away, buddy.
So since Anthony is the NBA champion, still the champion, I'm going to let him go first.
No problem. I started off real fast. Okay. Let's start with actual research. Okay, since the 1980s, there have been an abundance of researchers who, you know, want to study this 11th wonder in the world that we call momentum in sports. Okay, and regardless of what sport it is, in a different variety of sports, from golf to basketball, baseball, all of these different things, or every time the ones who actually try to come up with oh, well, this is momentum. It's always based on what they perceive or hindsight. It's never based on, well, I knew in that moment that this is momentum. It's like, oh, okay, well, this is the point that started a run that went on to this, so that's the momentum. Or this is the timeout that killed the run, so that's the end of the momentum. So this is the steal, this is the point, this is the fast break. It's always in hindsight. There's never a, I can point it out exactly. Oh, he just hit that three-pointer. That's it. That's about to start a 40-point run. And, you know, it's about, oh, they just hit that home run. Okay, that's about to start a three-run whatever. Or, you know the baseball terms. You know, I'm not fond of that. You know, all those things. You know, so that's how that y'all try to prove this mysterious thing of called momentum that can never again be predicted. But I'll let Andreas and everybody else go, and then I'm going to tell them exactly what momentum really is in sports, because it's not the way that they apply it.
I gotta say, you have a very, very fine talent for saying a lot and nothing at the same time.
All right, so, all right. Hey, clean, guys.
Let Team No Momentum go. They got their time. Yes. Their time.
And Andre,
also, citations needed. You said a lot of researchers. Citations needed.
Yeah. Did he get it? Did you get it from the young?
I got that information from sportsnews.com or something like that.
He edited a Wikipedia page. Let's be honest. He's going to slide a Wikipedia page that he edited himself. It's okay. I'm calling you right now.
Since this is like a 40-year-old study, I'm sure your Googles, your Bing, whatever search engine you use.
Bing.
You know, whatever search engine
can
you
use. Can I Google Bing? Does that still come up?
It might. Yahoo. What's the other one? They're all out there, whatever your search engine is.
Yeah. All right. Let's get back to the topic at hand. We could talk about some search engines another day, but we lose all our viewers. Anyway, Andres, you mentioned on your podcast, the Sports Fellows podcast, which you guys can access on Apple Podcasts and Spotify, SoundCloud too. Am I right?
Not SoundCloud, but not on SoundCloud, seven other platforms.
You're not a rapper. I got you. I understand. All right. So, Andres, go preface your statements. Make your opening opening little paragraph. Don't make it an essay or do. I don't really care. Go ahead. We got time.
I mean, it's pretty straightforward. It's just that momentum is not a real thing because, like, you as an individual, you can't determine what causes the momentum, right? If you're in a game, right, and a coach says, you know what, if Anthony Mullen makes a three-pointer, we're going to get momentum. So let's make it happen. The same thing in baseball. If you go up to Hank Aaron, you say, Hank Aaron, listen, if you hit a home run right here, we have all the momentum. It's not going to happen. Teams go on a 15-0 run because their defense stinks in that 2-3 minute period. You know, there's so many examples in different sports that there's no such thing as momentum. After game 5 of the NBA Finals, you know, Jimmy Butler went crazy. He was looking like Jesus Christ on the court. What happened? We got our asses whooped in game 6. Like, we got ran out of the building. If momentum was the real thing, then we probably would have won game 6 and won game 7. Another example, in the 2001 NBA Finals, I know you guys are old enough to remember this. Allen Iverson.
I wasn't even born.
You weren't even born. The other three gentlemen. Allen Iverson went into Staples Center. The Lakers were 15-0 heading into the finals, and Allen Iverson went into Staples Center, and he's like, you know what? I'm going to win this effing game. And they won in overtime. What happened the next game? What happened in the next 4 games? The Lakers won, right?
I believe
so. I'm not lying. You guys should Google it.
You're a Lakers fan.
Let me check the banner.
Right? So if I Google 2001 NBA champions, is it going to say that the Sixers won because of the momentum of game 1 of the 7th sense of Allen Iverson? Or is it going to say Los Angeles Lakers won their 14th championship?
All right, I got some questions queued up. Hold on.
Opening Steph, statement. I just have a question before I let you rock out, Steph.
No, you're going to start. You can start.
Oh, all right. So besides Anthony talking for 3.5 minutes and saying absolutely nothing,
I said a whole lot.
Nice, Craig.
What you comprehend is not up to me. Like that's not my.
I'm on his side right now. So you calm down by comprehension. He got high comprehension skills.
All right.
So you said that nobody ever talked about winning a game because of momentum.
Who said that?
Andres, he just said that. That was like part of his closing statement. Nobody ever won a game because...
You gotta pay attention to your partner, bro.
Oh, no.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear it. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
But the problem is you guys are looking at momentum in a micro, in a macro perspective instead of micro. You're looking at it game to game when, in essence, momentum is like a pendulum. It swings, it can swing back and forth. You can do things to stop another team's momentum within the game. That's why, you know, NBA coaches call timeouts on those 15-0 runs you discussed. Because, hey, that other team gained momentum and we need to impede their process so we can regroup. What'd you say?
Go on a run. That's when NBA teams go on a run, like you call a timeout to stop that. Like they are building momentum. Like when your defense can't stop them, you like that is the cause. You call a timeout to stop that momentum to gain some of that back. Energy is very real. Hey, we gave you time to talk.
Right, bro. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I appreciate the respect on Smoke and Mirrors. Thank you.
I have to write this stuff down. I'm sorry.
He's playing the show card.
I got my notebook. You get your notebook.
Write this stuff down.
All right, Greg, finish up.
Now. And just to give a couple broad-based examples before I get into specifics, right? You gave the Lakers an AI, right?
Correct.
And that series, you're talking about the series. But even within the game, there's momentum. You know, look at the Giants in 2011, right? You think they were 9-7. They were a wild card team. You think momentum had nothing to do with that run? Absolutely nothing? That's what you're telling me?
No. No, because it's not a real thing.
They're not believers, by no means.
But with all due respect, I forgot to say thank you for the invite to the Smoke and Mirrors podcast.
No problem. I forgot to say that at the beginning.
So, Declan didn't want to get background information. This all started because on my podcast, I said that momentum isn't a real thing. So me and my friend got into an argument. So Greg clipped it, and then he posted it in the group.
Manny clipped it for me. Shout out to Manny.
All right,
that is true.
Greg, you finish? Oh, I'm sorry. I want to make sure we're staying on track. Greg, did you finish your point? Right. I want to make sure you finish your point.
Yeah.
I give my point. And then these two.
That's just my opening statement. I don't want to give them everything off rip. So that's, go ahead, Steph.
As I did. Right.
You don't want to give us the momentum. I got you, bro. Right.
But if that momentum doesn't, never mind. All right. So if your opening statements are finished, I'd like to get into some questions.
Wait, Steph didn't even give us.
Wait.
Go yet?
Come on, man.
Oh, we didn't. All right. Well, yeah. Then what the hell was that?
I'm going to work through my point a little bit. So, sure. From what I hear from the both of you and Andres, that you know, it's not an exact science, so it doesn't exist, right? Just because you can't understand something doesn't mean it doesn't exist, though. And I think that's again to your point and comprehension. You can't comprehend momentum, therefore it doesn't exist. But that's just you. And I think as athletes. If you play the sport, also fans can feel momentum as well. And I want to get into something because I think it's important, you know, when you talk about games, because you mentioned a few games. To me, one of the biggest phenomenons that took place was the 2004 ALCS against the Red Sox and the Yankees. Right.
The Red Sox won that series because the Yankees folded, not because of momentum.
I'm going to go through it. You can stop right there. So
let's go through and then I got a little quote about that. But go ahead.
Yeah. So I'm not going to take up too much time. I'll try to rush through this as much as I can. But you have Curt Schilling start that game one, right? Curt Schilling, the ace coming in. Obviously, they're playing at Yankee Stadium. So the Yankees are home. And Curt Schilling ends up giving up two runs in that first inning, actually gives up three runs in that first inning, which, you know, it's not substantial, but it's enough. Then you have later in the third inning.
Sounds like momentum.
The Red Sox still scoreless. The Yankees, now, because Hideki Matsui had a game. The Yankees end up putting up six runs. All right, they got six runs total in the third inning, so up to six runs now. By the seventh inning, the Red Sox hadn't got a hit yet. In the top of the seventh was the first hit they received that they ever had in that game.
Who had the momentum?
Are you asking rhetorical questions? It sounds like a rhetorical question. You want to answer yourself?
No.
Because it's clearly the Red Sox.
You just said the Red Sox had not hit a run in that game.
They had not gotten a hit up to that point, the seventh inning. This is a team that obviously
going into it. They just the Yankees, right?
Yes.
So you're admitting there's momentum?
What is the point?
No, I'm getting to my point. So now we're
But it's not your point. It's my point.
The Yankees won, right? No, I'm waiting. Okay, finish the.
That would, that let him cook. Let him cook.
Go ahead.
It's a simmer, bro. You operate at a level six with your burner. I'll be starting at a 2 to 3. Let me get there. Thank you. So, like I was saying before, I was so rudely interrupted. I respected your time. I'm going to reclaim my time.
I'm sorry.
Thank
you. I'm sorry.
All right. You got your time back. Let's go. Come on.
So, so the Red Sox score five again.
So
in that seventh inning, the Red Sox end up putting up a good amount of runs. Actually, between the seventh and the eighth, they score five runs. Thank you. Yep. You're on it. I appreciate you. All right. Five runs, right? Which then they come back. They end up, because the Yankees at that point in the eighth inning, scored two more runs. So they went from eight to actually they score four runs in total because they end up I'm moving too quickly here.
They were up, they were up 8-7, and then the Yankees scored two runs in the bottom.
They were only down by one, and then the Yankees in the bottom of the eighth end up getting two more runs.
Yeah,
and end up pushing the Red Sox in a first and second situation top of the ninth, where the Red Sox ground out into a double play. Now, what I'm saying is, in that game, if you have a one run game, it's a different beast. The Red Sox were trailing until the seventh inning. They did not have momentum, but as Greg said, it is a pendulum. The Red Sox gained some steam and some traction. It is energy. Energy is everything. Don't wait. It's a long series, right? It's not one game. It's not the NFL. It's more than one game. So I'm going to skip ahead. Games two and three play out very similar. Pedro Martinez starts game two, and he gives up three runs over six innings. The Red Sox only put up one run in the eighth. If you look at that box score.
What game was this?
That's game two.
Game two, we lost 3-1. We didn't lose. We didn't get three or four, five, six runs scored on.
Pedro, I said three runs. Pedro gave up three runs in six innings.
You just said six, bro.
What? I said he gave up three runs in the sixth inning. You heard me.
He said he gave up three runs in the sixth inning. Go ahead.
But in six innings, he gave up three runs, and they didn't score until the eighth. So what I'm telling you is, the Yankees were riding that. If you watch the series between games one and three, no one in the stadium, no one watching at home would tell you that the Yankees would not score a run. They controlled the momentum of that series up to those three games. Now, what happens in game four is a little interesting because it was back and forth. Now you have the Red Sox are home because in game three they were home and they made some noise in game three, but they end up ultimately losing. Whereas in game four, they did 19-8. They had 11 unanswered runs. Because that's when the team gets crushed. And I don't know if you got, again, if you played sports, you know this feeling. It's the moment when your butthole is no longer tight. It's loose. There's no loose butthole in a stadium when you were falling behind. Hey, anyone that plays a sport knows. Booty. It's tension. It's called pressure. Lemon booty. It is pressure. either way.
Now we got pressure, we got momentum.
It's all synonymous. They work together. That doesn't mean they have to be separate.
Which comes first, the momentum or the pressure?
All right, but if it works together, it works together.
Let me finish up. So let me go ahead because y'all are really rude and not letting me finish on my point. I know it's long, but
I'll make sure that everyone can finish on their points. But go ahead.
Come on, man. It's like a DBQS day, bro.
Hey, you know what?
I blame Declan for his 7-minute introduction.
Either way,
like I said, but go ahead.
You have games 4, 5, and 6, right? So games 4 and 5 are interesting because they were close. You had the game 4, which they win in extra innings, the 14th inning. Big Poppy hits a walk-off home run, you know. And then game 5, you see that the Red Sox take the lead for the first time in the series. They go up 2-0 in the beginning of that game, but they only needed 4 runs that game to win. That was the same game when Alex Rodriguez slapped the ball out of Bronson Arroyo's hand.
That was game six.
You're right. I'm sorry. That's game six. That's the Bloody Sock game. You're right. I misspoke there. But
and that's momentum, still, by the way.
No, but still, that doesn't change my point though. Game five, you see, it's 4-2. The Red Sox only needed 4 runs early in that season. I'm sorry, early in that series, 4 runs would not have been enough for the Red Sox to win. The Yankees started to feel that momentum shift. They started to see a change in the way that they played. This team was dominating for 3 whole games, and then all of a sudden, games 4 and 5, they lose it. That energy does play a part.
Would you say A-Rod slapping the glove out of his hand was a turning point?
Yes. So in game six, when A-Rod does that, that is pressure. That is him trying to make something happen because he's afraid of losing. They were down and he needed to do something to make it happen. That's what happens when you press. When I talk about a loose butthole or a tight one, the tight one happens.
Yes, you don't have to talk about that, by the way.
No, I will. I will. No, I will talk about that because momentum is a feeling. It's energy. We're
no,
human
it's
beings.
Not.
Let's stop. You'll make your point when you're ready to talk. I'm going to finish my point, though.
You've been talking
so,
for 15
like
minutes.
I was saying, and I'm sorry. I came prepared and you didn't come prepared. So
I just thought we would have an opening and then a closing.
And this is my opening. It got interrupted several times, so you're going to have to shut up now.
You're right.
Go ahead, Steph. Come on.
Either way, the energy is a part of momentum for that same fact. If we were robots, momentum would mean nothing because it wouldn't have an impact on how you feel. As an athlete, when I am up one run in the eighth inning and someone starts with a leadoff double, so there's no outs with runner on second, I start to press. I'm sure my team starts to press. You can't calculate that in real time. It's a feeling, though. It's a collective feeling. And that impacts the game. Stop. That impacts the game. Game seven, by comparison to everything else that happened in that series, was not even close. The Yankees, who were in every game, just about, except for game six and seven, really, were in it and looked like they can make anything happen. They didn't even look like the same team by that point. It was a battle of attrition because momentum swung both ways, and then the Red Sox took it and seized it in the moment and ended up winning that series with the biggest upsets in sports history. And then they took that same momentum and won the World Series. It's as simple as understanding that energy does have an impact on players. As a player, when you are in that moment, knowing that the pressure is on, momentum adds pressure to any one of those situations.
All right.
Right. Does the moderator have a question?
That wraps up the first little opening statements here. I got a quick question, and this goes to both of you guys. When a basketball team is going on a run and the opposing team calls a timeout, what is the point of that timeout? What are they looking to stop? And I'm sure you guys both have different answers.
Oh, go ahead.
Anthony,
go
ahead.
Go ahead. Absolutely.
Yeah, go ahead, Anthony.
First of all, they call a timeout because, as we all know in sports, it's a copycat league. So that's just what strategically is the common thing to do in those situations, which is why it's situational.
But what's the point of it?
Call it strategic.
It's why it's situational, because coaches like Phil Jackson never called timeouts in no situation, and he made his team figure it out. So now, is the timeout what swung the momentum, or is it the team actually executing which swung the momentum? Because it seems like momentum is only when I'm executing and the other team isn't executing. That's not momentum. Momentum should be, again, as long as I'm executing, you know, I'm going straight. That's momentum. I'm going straight forth in my execution, and this is going to last, again, throughout the game.
Why does it have to last throughout the game?
There's literally times where teams that play the Spurs, the other team gets an opening bucket, and Pop calls a timeout literally after the opening bucket. Why does he do that? It wasn't no 15-0 run, no 17-0 run. He literally does it after the opening bucket.
I mean, to your point, each coach has different philosophies. But if he does that, he's probably trying to stop anything further from happening.
That's what it sounds like to me. I think Pop and any other coach would understand that momentum is a thing. To me, if you do that, it's because you're acknowledging that fact. It would make no other sense otherwise. What do you think it is? Since you're asking the question, you have an answer.
No, I'm asking you because you're saying
that
momentum.
I'm asking you back. I just gave my answer, but what is your answer? Because what do you think it is? Because I told you what my answer is.
Because the defense falls apart. That's literally what I said before. Teams go on 15-0 runs because the defense falls apart, not because there's no momentum.
The defense falls apart within the first 8 seconds.
You guys said the momentum happens because of fans, right? What happened in the bubble?
I didn't say because of fans.
No, that's not what we said.
That never happened.
That's what you guys were saying earlier. In the bubble, there was no fans.
So how did teams get this momentum?
I didn't mention fans.
No fans in the bubble.
No, y'all did.
What you're doing is you're bringing in outside factors into this debate that we're having here currently.
I haven't mentioned
fans. All right, but you know what? On the topic of fans.
So Anthony Davis hit a game-winning shot against the Nuggets, right? And the Lakers had all the momentum heading into the next game. What happened in the next game?
I told you, momentum doesn't necessarily mean game to game. All right, I am answering you.
Would you guys say that momentum, Anthony? Not to cut you off, but would you guys say that momentum is momentum until it's not?
There's no such thing as momentum, bro.
See, okay, well, how do you answer a question like that?
No, it's always perception. That's what you just said. That's always their explanation. As momentum until it's not momentum. Oh, that's the timeout that stopped the momentum. Oh, that. So what?
It was that bucket that stopped the momentum.
Y'all bring up situations where it matches, but what about majority of the situations where said timeout is had and then another run is just put on top of the last run? That's because they suck, not because they have momentum. They're just not good enough.
Yeah. It doesn't have anything to do with momentum. It's funny because you're only talking in absolutes. Like, oh, if you get momentum, you have to win the whole game. It doesn't work that way. It's not
an exact science. Yes, you do have to win the whole game because
that's not even reality. Your argument is not based in reality.
But listen, and again, be respectful. I'll let you guys speak when you speak. Let me finish my point when I'm making a point, please. Thank you. So it's not an absolute. It's not a science to it because it is energy, right? It is like a feeling that players have and it doesn't pack them. To say that, calling a timeout won't change anything, it's not always going to work. It doesn't always work that way. You don't always get the win when you take momentum because it does sway. Again, it's a pendulum. It does go both ways. One team having momentum doesn't mean the other team will not then seize that momentum. It can happen. It happens with every play, right? And really what it comes to is when you overcome that pressure, because momentum does build pressure. When you start to feel helpless, when, again, going back to baseball, if 6 or 7 runs are put up in the 7th inning against me and now we're down big, as a player coming up to the plate, it's like that's a huge mountain to climb. Think of it that way, right? Instead of a little molehill, if it's one run, very doable. Wait your turn. Thank you. I see your hand. Declan, we'll get to you. It's a molehill. Right, as opposed to 7 runs, which is a mountain, it changes how players approach games, even how coaches have a different strategy. So to say that it's non-existent at all just because it's not throughout the entire game is foolhardy. You, to me, are trying to, like, arithmetic. You're trying to solve for X, but you stop halfway through it. Yes, there can be it can end up being a landslide, but sometimes it isn't. It's not perfect because it isn't a science.
Right.
Okay. That's what momentum is. Literally physics, though. It's literally a science.
So here's the thing.
That's for physical objects, bro.
Moderator, can I ask a question?
You want to talk about inertia while we're at it? What? All right. Stop.
Everybody calm down. Andres, go ahead. What do you got to say?
So, Stefan, you consider yourself a baseball fan, correct?
Yes, I am.
Okay. What happened in Game 5 of the American League Championship Series last year?
That was between.
Oh, wait! I'm talking to Stephen.
No!
I'm just giving context for the viewers.
Yeah, but tell me. I don't. Offhand, I'm okay. Forgetting the exact.
Carlos Correa hit a walk-off home run, right? And the Astros won Game 5. What happened in Game 6? The Astros won again, right? So surely all the momentum from Game 4, 5, and 6 carried into Game 7. Declan, can you remind the people what happened in Game 7?
That doesn't prove anything.
How does that prove nothing?
Who was the starting pitcher in Game 7 for both teams?
Blake Snell. Blake Snell.
Okay, fine. And who was the Astros guy?
McCullers Jr. Maybe, possibly.
Okay.
No, so that's Charlie Morton did. Charlie Morton and Lance McCullers Jr.
Yeah. So you got a Cy Young for Tampa Bay. You know. Right. Going up against,
would you say that momentum
starter.
Is the momentum is the
next? Oh, so that matters. Greg.
Just to give an example,
of course it matters. I told you. You're looking at it from a macro point of view, but you refuse to pay attention to the minor details that go into everything within the game. You keep talking about the overall outcome instead of talking about the game.
Yes, because
game.
That's all that matters.
No, it's not all that matters. You sound stupid, bro. It's not all that matters. Yo,
you're talking about feelings.
No, everybody I'm not talking about filling. And you were talking about
team sport, bro. Everyone wants to win.
And you were talking about definitions, right? There's two definitions. The first definition talks about physics. The second one is a strength or force gained by motion or by a series of events.
Thank you. Thank you. Which is why I'm going to tell you what momentum is. When you
a series of events, exactly what we just discussed. A series of events. Blake Snell being up 1-0 in Game 6 of the World Series, pitching his ass off, and then getting pulled.
I knew you were going to bring that up. I come prepared.
Completely
I continue.
Changed
continue,
the momentum
continue,
of
please.
That particular
That's what you perceive
game.
Changed the game.
How
That's
is it perceived? You don't even watch the game.
That's what you perceived again in hindsight. So when that happened, you knew that the game would change at that moment.
Yes, Literally, you exactly was the best pitcher on the field.
You're telling me
you knew exactly what was going to happen was going to happen once he did that.
They put in there was a pitcher.
There was a higher likelihood exactly of it happening. Why do you have to know what happened?
Exactly, but you can tell that he
had that's what momentum is.
No, but it's Edge.
Bro, you're out of your depth here, bro. You're so out of your depth here. You sound wild.
So you're telling me that the Tampa Bay Rays were going to beat the best team in baseball without getting a runner to third base since the second inning because they took out Blake Snell. That's what you're telling me.
Blake Snell gives them a better chance to win.
You're trying to ignore facts to prove an illegitimate point.
That's not how it works.
How many times did the Dodgers only one run in the whole season? How many times did the Dodgers only run one run the whole fucking season?
Does that have to do with their playoff series?
Hold on. Why is there such thing as a clutch player if everybody so-called feels this pressure? Isn't that what a killer is?
Those players overcome that adversity. That's exactly why they're clutch.
I'm not done with my question. Because I don't believe in clutch. There's no the clutch moments, which I want to call clutch moments, is not clutch moments as far as the end of the game. Because again, if momentum was actually real, everything that swung the momentum would actually be the most clutch moments. Correct.
But again, you ever hear them? No, look, you ever look at a mundane point.
What comes
first?
You asked a question, right? I'm answering your question. Do you ever see somebody talk about a turning point of a game? Those are momentum shifts. That's not hindsight.
That's hindsight.
Sorry.
Somebody pull out a Webster's for this guy. No. He don't even know what he's talking about, bro.
I just want to say this. The way you guys are speaking, it's as if someone has an edge, they're supposed to win. Like, it's supposed to happen. It's a sport.
What's the point of the game? What's the point of the game?
No, what's the point of the game? What do you mean? The point of the game is to get to an end and have a decision.
It's to win. But it's not to win. It doesn't matter what other variables play into it.
Stop. I'm saying
that there's no strategy to get to the win. No, just ask me a question.
I guess Declan, I hear what you're saying, but what I'm saying is you're not answering my question by saying that's the win. It doesn't mean anything when you say that. You just said words really loudly. Proud of you. But I said an edge.
That Greg was doing.
With your logic, you're saying an edge should be the reason why they win. But because there are a bunch of variables in any game leading to those clutch players, those superstars that can overcome adversity, overcome pressure, they can be the difference makers. Even the mundane player, the average player, can overcome. Bill Mueller in that same series has a clutch single that ends up pushing the Red Sox through, having them tie the game. Like, it doesn't always have to be the clutch player, but there are clutch moments. But to say that it's supposed to be, and as soon as they have an edge, as soon as they win game one and they dominate, they have to win everything, is to, again, talking absolutes. And it is a facile argument because you're not taking in the smaller aspects of each game that impacts players. I'm not saying that it's momentum is everything. You're making it seem like momentum is nothing.
That's what
momentum is a part of the game. You're saying it doesn't exist at all.
If
your point was that momentum doesn't have as much of an impact, you might have an argument. But you're saying it doesn't exist at all, and you're wrong for that. There are multiple components of how a game is played out and what impacts a game. To say that momentum is not a part of it is to be foolish and to not understand any sport,
you
really.
Said that is feeling. But you cannot gauge how somebody is feeling in a moment.
No. I got a question for both of y'all. Both of you.
Momentum.
Have either of you guys played in a game, in a high-stakes game, an organized sport?
Why do you bring up feelings? Go ahead.
Not an organized sport.
We're human. Because, we have because feelings, it's
bro. Because feelings emotion is tied into momentum.
Everybody let Greg speak. Let's relax. Greg's got
to literally tied into it.
Go ahead.
What sport did you play, Andres?
Me, baseball.
Okay, perfect. Perfect. So you're telling me if it's the team I'm pitching, right? Team hits three singles in the bottom of the eighth, and they're down one, right? No outs. And I then strike out the next three hitters after that. Who had the momentum first, and then how? And then what happened?
We had the momentum because we were batting, and there was three. Uh-huh. I'm answering his question. So we had the momentum because three singles were hit, and mm-hmm. then you had the momentum because you shut them down with your 99 mile per hour fastball.
But that's my point. That is the pendulum swing within the game that allows momentum to go from one side to another. So it doesn't determine the outcome, but it can shift from team to team.
Why did it take you three singles for you to gain the momentum to strike out the next three players?
Because that's how things happen. You're not always going to get every out. You're not always going to strike everybody out. That like you're not. This is why I say you're arguing.
If you don't strike those players out, also in that situation, so that means you don't have the momentum.
No. Because if you get out that inning, even if I don't strike those three guys out, and say there's a pop out and then a double play to end the inning, the momentum still shifts because they didn't score with bases loaded and no outs. That is huge, especially in the bottom of the eighth inning.
Johnny Damon hit a grand slam in Game 7 because of momentum. Not because who was the starting pitcher that day for the Yankees gave up three straight hits.
Kevin Brown.
There we go.
That's my point. All of that plays into the momentum. Kevin Brown wasn't pitching well, and the Red Sox strung together hits, built up momentum, and got to Johnny Damon. And
that was the biggest game for the Red Sox in that
you
series.
Only say that because the other team, again, in hindsight, because the other
what team changed? In hindsight, bro, you don't even know what it means.
I'm sorry. Hold on, real quick though. What changed with that team? It's the same players on the field, just like Pedro. Fell apart mentally. You really gonna say that? Stop it. I'm not saying that they fell apart mentally. No, I think that they were overwhelmed by that same momentum that the Red Sox had. Kurt Schilling, the same guy that got shellacked in the first game, goes into game six and pulls out the win. It's the same players that are playing, bro. How could the game become so lopsided in game seven for the Red Sox and the Yankees with the same players playing? With your logic, it's supposed to just make sense. The Yankees should have just won, but they didn't. And I'm just saying,
Andres,
I'm saying that you're taking this situation and saying it's supposed to apply to everything. It's cookie cutter. It's not cookie cutter.
I gave you an example of when it happened.
But when you speak about things retrospectively, when you speak about things retrospectively, just for the both of you to understand, it gives you more insight. You can't have that much insight in the moment. If you ever play a game, because you both played, you said, to be in a game and be able to have an outside perspective is near impossible because you're in the middle of it. When you talk about things retrospectively, you can see the insights and understand, oh, that moment makes sense. Why the energy changed for that team. Team dugouts tell you how much, or just a bench tells you how much energy.
How can
shift.
You watching the game gauge energy?
Yo, you didn't you just say players, that. As a bro. Laker fan, you didn't just say that. Shut it down.
Don't try to.
How can you gauge energy? You can't gauge body language by watching people. You can't do that.
Say that again.
It's psychological. Why? I mean, are we just dense? If you're dense,
you just said the Yankees fell apart mentally.
No, I said I'm not saying that the Yankees falling apart mentally was nothing to do with it. I ceded to some of your point. It had something to do with it. I'm not telling you that. Oh, the Yankees are a bad team. They got pummeled by that momentum that the Red Sox had. Game six and seven were different games.
Game six and seven of that series
was very different than one and two and three.
Everybody
relax. Quick question for Anthony based on what he said. He said that.
He's the host. You've been asking us questions. Why don't you ask the other side questions?
I was getting to the questions, but you know what? Maybe we didn't expect this debate to go 6 hours. We're going to get to dinner time. But you know what? Happy reminder that we do have extra time today. So let's use it. Anthony said energy cannot be gauged by fans. Is that what you said?
I said, how is he gauging their feelings? Yes.
Right. So my follow-up question to you as a moderator would be, do you believe in home field advantage? And shout out to Travis for this question because you don't believe in home field advantage?
No.
You're also talking to a guy who doesn't believe in clutch anything. So he's consistent in being ridiculous.
And nobody should really believe in home field advantage because it's shown to mean absolutely nothing.
Every team that has home field advantage should win the respective series.
That's not what it means. It means they have the edge. It doesn't mean they're going to win. Edge. This is why y'all keep speaking in absolutes.
But if your edge still brings you 40 ticks below the level of my team, what edge did it give you?
It doesn't mean that it lasts throughout the game.
I'll say it again. If your edge basically makes you a little bit less a little bit more skill, but that's still way less talented.
No, the skill levels are about the same. About skill. The edge isn't about skill. It's
so what
about,
edge is it giving
it's
you?
About the emotional factor played in that plays into momentum.
So you really think,
again,
so
psychological.
You really think the, so you really think the Kobe and Shaq Lakers or whatever felt so, I guess, hurt or emotional about going into what was a scrub team, like in Atlanta or something like that, or Hawks or whatever, whoever was the bottom half team. You think just because fans are yelling at them and all that, that that's going to affect them as far as like if they win the game or not? No,
yeah,
whether they take them whether they take them serious more so will affect them than the fans or anybody. In fact, players have actually said that they love playing against when the fans are against them and stuff like that.
Why?
So don't
why? No. Why do they get excited?
Don't tell me.
Why do they get excited?
Don't dictate to players how they feel and they told you how they
why
feel.
Why do the players get excited in opposing stadiums? Why?
You said it's a disadvantage and it's actually an advantage to some. Again, going back to what
some.
Your brother said.
Why
about the
do
booty?
Players get
lemon
excited
booty.
When they're
lemon
on the road?
Lemon booty is not universal. Okay, lemon booty is subjective and depending on the person. If you're that soft and you get lemon booty,
why
that's
do
on
play
you.
It to your point,
it doesn't exist though.
Why do players get excited when they're on the road?
Because everyone's betting against them.
Because they get fired up from the energy of someone giving them negative feedback and
but
saying,
"I'm
going to
beat you." But
you just
said that affects them negatively. Hold on, just said that
you
they
said
have the other
different.
Team has an advantage. All right.
So
you so said
let me
that
get, let me give you an example. Since clearly both of y'all are lying, and none of y'all never played no sport. Period.
Said,
because
no,
y'all wouldn't make this
now.
Argument.
You said the energy is supposed Kristen to give them a disadvantage.
Again.
So how does energy that gives them an advantage?
I'm sorry. Continue.
How does
continue.
Energy that's supposed
Steph,
to give
I got
them
this
a disadvantage?
One.
No, I just want to say I want to speak go for after.
Guys, let Angel let Anthony talk.
Yeah, no, I was gonna let him finish.
All right.
How is energy that's supposed to be a disadvantage an advantage?
I got the perfect example for you.
No, I'm gonna just go first and you can give your example.
The Lakers,
Andres, hold on. We're doing this order, right?
Yeah,
so don't apply your argument to mine. You're talking in absolutes. I'm not saying
I'm talking about you said feelings.
Yes, but that doesn't have to be for everyone, bro. You're talking in absolutes. You're saying just because an edge works for a team or works for several players doesn't mean it's everyone. I'm not saying that it has to be everyone. When I go up to bat with a gun, going back to baseball, when you go up to bat, I could be the weak link, you know, feeling that pressure, whereas the next guy behind me might not feel that pressure. That does not mean that momentum has nothing to do with it. Your argument is that it has nothing to do with it. You can't make that, again, speaking in absolutes, that's not what I'm saying. I am saying that it has an impact on the game, several players. It's a team sport we're talking about. Any individual player can be impacted by momentum. Sometimes it works so that everyone is clicking, but it doesn't always click like that. And as an athlete, you would know if you play a team sport that you're not always clicking. Some people are clicking and you're not. And momentum plays a part in that. So again, you saying it doesn't exist
actually,
is why I say you're wrong.
Momentum. No. You just realize how that defines momentum because if they were
you're talking
clicking,
about physical objects,
you
would, bro,
you wouldn't have nowhere to point
that's energy.
Momentum.
Clicking
if it's
is energy.
A close game, if it's a close game, where do you point momentum to? If there's no big runs, if everything is close the whole way through, where
it's
do
a
you
stalemate.
Point momentum to?
It could be a stalemate. That happens in sports too. It doesn't have to always be left, right. It could be dead center. What are you talking
now, like,
about,
do you
bro?
Guys see, and Travis been asking some good
like,
questions.
Like once you have an edge, what? Let's say you get that run, then the momentum can shift to the other team because then there's pressure on them to then
the
answer.
Momentum is
the
never
energy.
Even.
The energy magically flows
momentum.
To the other team. The Lakers.
Right, well, saying that energy doesn't exist is an asinine argument to me because like we're all humans. The game has
the
an
Lakers,
impact on how we play.
The Lakers have 17 championships because of momentum, not because of they have.
Who said they won because of momentum?
You're making
you
an argument that we're not making.
No,
that's not what we're saying.
That's what you guys sound like, bro.
This tells me that your comprehension levels are not as high as you think they are.
You're not understanding what we're saying. You're talking in absolutes. Don't apply that to our argument. You're saying that there's no momentum because it can't unless it's for all or nothing. We're not saying that. Don't apply that. Do not apply that to our argument. Do not apply your argument to ours. Understand what you're saying and what I'm saying. I'm not saying that just because they go on a run, they should win the game. That's what you're saying. And I say you're wrong for that reason.
That's
because
the truth, though.
It does not make sense.
No, that's again. That doesn't make sense.
Lead changes in basketball happen very frequently, but it can change how the outcome of the game is. I'm not telling you that it's going to be the reason why they win. Getting 50 points in a row gives you a really good chance of winning a game. Does that mean they will win? No. But
if
with your
goes,
argument,
listen,
with your argument, with your argument,
bucket,
they
if
should
a team
win.
Goes bucket for bucket, if a team goes bucket for bucket for 47 and 55, and one team has the ball for the last 5 seconds, who has the momentum in that moment?
It's the team that's the up ball.
If they're going bucket to bucket.
So how do we know that the team that has the ball has momentum? If they
actually no,
bucket,
not even it's not even
hindsight,
no.
Andreas. That's how we it's know based on who won.
What does that even mean? What is being hindsight doesn't mean
he's just throwing words out just to see if people know what they mean.
But anyway, I'm sorry.
Y'all keep saying that. How doesn't hindsight apply? Do you know what that means?
Yes, I know what it means. And because we're talking about things that have actually happened. Things that we're not talking about hindsight. We're talking about retrospect.
I spoke to that. You can conflate the two. What I'm saying is, and I spoke to that earlier, retrospect gives you more insight.
Didn't happen? That means something that didn't happen?
No, I'm not saying you're wrong. I didn't say
that's
you're wrong.
You're applying hindsight incorrectly into our argument.
How is it incorrect is what I actually... context of how I'm using hindsight is wrong.
I don't think he's wrong. I think that he's saying that when you look back at this game, hindsight's 20/20 or retrospect, you are saying I learned something by looking at this information after the game played. And like I said earlier, that you get more insight after the game because you could look at things when you can't look at live. And I'm not saying that there's nothing there. But to say that hindsight is, again, absolute. So all you guys are speaking about is an absolute. Oh, you can only see that in hindsight, only in retrospect. But yes, you get more information. That doesn't mean that there was zero information there. Those same decisions, they infect strategy. It's still a part of it.
To Anthony's point earlier, before I had to run.
And then I got a question after this. Go ahead.
To talking about energies. Not every player is created the same. When I'm pitching stadiums and I'm getting booed, that fires me up. That makes me want to go at it. But then I've coached players who can't handle that, and they don't like getting booed. And I have to coach them back up to get them back out there.
Because so they're human, and they have feelings, and it affects them.
That booing affects their momentum as a player, as an individual player.
Whereas, how they perform is affected by the moment, like what's happening.
Notice
in the
game. How everything I said in my initial statement, exactly all the
you mean nothing?
Timeouts, runs, crowd noise.
Oh, so
all these things is what you again perceive as momentum shift.
Reality isn't perception. Reality is not perception.
And hindsight.
Let me say it again. Reality is not perception. These things actually happen. People have human emotions.
It's how you. It's how you're seeing it, though. That's what I'm saying.
Deck.
It's
how Deck, I'm
you
sorry.
Want to see it.
Can we get to those questions by Travis when this finishes?
Yeah. So listen, I got a couple questions. I'll get to Travis's question, and then I got a question for the Polis brothers, because I know we got to ask questions to both sides. That's how a debate works. And also happy to say we can go over, so we're all right. I haven't got the go from Speedy yet, but everyone, stick around. We're still going. Okay. My question is to everybody here. When you have a brawl – actually, we'll go to the Polis brothers, and then you guys can answer. But just have the flowing conversation like you guys have been having.
Yeah,
but,
I mean, we've been asking questions.
I'm letting the guys play. I'm not throwing any flags today, all right? But anyway.
Do your thing.
All right, here's the deal. So when there's a brawl, right, in a game, like you say, what comes to mind immediately, Travis and Reverson, but what comes to mind is, the Malice at the Palace. When fans are involved in the brawl, or Auburn Hills, like Travis referenced, do you think that has anything to do with the home field advantage? Not even an advantage, but the home field emotion that you guys have been talking about.
No, I think that's a poor example on either side, because that was just a case of a fan being belligerent and a player not taking it. That I don't think that had to do with the game itself. Like, the fan threw a cup of beer at Ron Artest and he reacted. You know, I don't know if that had to do with the game itself.
All right.
Yeah.
And unless you guys, anyone have anything to say, or can I go to the next question?
No, I'm in agreement with Greg.
Go ahead, Anthony. Go ahead, man.
No, I just wanted to say, so when Draymond was suspended, you don't feel like that had anything to do with the Golden State Warriors losing that series?
It could have played. It played a role.
Huh?
I said it played a role.
But I thought momentum don't go game to game and stuff like that. Like,
yo, I think it's cute that you said got you, but I literally said momentum is a game within a game from game. So you have one game, the momentum.
You're playing with Triple H, man. Time to play the game.
You move with it. You
I don't think
pendulum
that's a
swings.
Moment. Just because you laugh doesn't mean anything. I'm
yeah,
sorry.
I mean, you just because you're laughing at stupidity, it just makes me stupid.
I got another
Let him go. Let him go.
There's pendulum swings within every game. And again, Draymond getting suspended was an outside factor that affected said momentum within the series. So just because you think it's this some kind of gotcha, it's not. Because
I'm glad you said that. So when he came back, that should have swung it back the other way.
Should have, but that's not necessarily the case because why? Momentum is not finite. It is not absolute. Thank you for proving. You should just end right there because they just proved our debate for us.
I got one question after this, and then we can end it. And I'm
glad. I'm ready for the question whenever they finish.
All right. You guys got something to say,
Chris? Andre, I think he does.
I just want to know.
Go ahead.
I'm still here.
In a nine-inning game, right? The away team scores the first run in the ninth inning, right? So now they have the momentum. So now that means that you should win
the
game.
What's the score?
No, we just
0-0.
How many times have we this tells me that you hear but you don't listen. Because we have said continuously that just because they score first and they gain the first momentum doesn't mean
he's saying he's saying 0-0, right? He's saying 0-0 in the ninth inning, top of the ninth, right? Is that what the example was?
Correct.
And the away team just put up a run, which means at the bottom of the ninth, the home team has to score. There's pressure on that home team now to deliver. If in eight innings, they weren't able to score, and then the first run comes across in the top of the ninth, yes, I would give momentum to that away team because now as a home team, I have to go up, I have to perform, right? And that again, it's pressure because momentum can end up causing pressure on a team, putting pressure on a team. You have that. Right. So, yes, the home team is going into it now pressing because they have to get that run. If they don't, if they get down two outs, no runners on, what is that doing to the psyche of everyone up there? Like it's do or die at the plate. Right. So that it has a factor. I'm not saying that they're going to win or they're going to lose. You keep talking about it being like, they have to win now or they have to lose now. Because I'm saying that it plays a part. It has a part. You keep saying that. I have no point said that a team with an edge or a team that has momentum should win. That series with, again, the Red Sox and the Yankees should have won, and they didn't. You know, you keep saying, it's a mental breakdown from the fourth. Games one through three, they stunk, but they put up enough runs to win, and then game four was like a revelation. It's the energy in the game. It can volley. You keep talking in absolutes. Do not apply that to my argument because I'm not saying that. It's a factor. It plays a part in the overall game. There are components to a game, and that's one of them for me. You're saying it's not, and you're wrong for it.
I talked to you about the whole Rudy Gobert thing. So,
but I'm saying
I believe you're wrong. That's my opinion.
Listen, so Johnny Damon hit a grand slam because of momentum. Johnny Damon stole second base because of momentum.
I didn't say because of momentum.
David Ortiz hit a walk-off home run because of momentum, because the Red Sox had all the momentum.
You're the only one making that point. Everything happens because of momentum. I said it has a factor in the overall game, bro.
You don't just hit a grand slam with nobody on base, right? So things happened that helped the Red Sox gain momentum. Guys got on base. The momentum's in their favor. If you get up with the bases loaded, you are a lot more confident to hit than if you get up with no one on base. That's momentum.
Yeah, I mean, if you're saying no to that, then you never come on. But you haven't hit in that situation.
Shut it down. Shut it down.
I'm not going to shut it down. We got to 2:30.
He said you're not more confident going up to hit with the bases loaded.
You can prove that you're more confident. Can you prove that?
Absolutely.
Hold on.
It's a personal thing. You can't how you say prove. It's
hold on. Wait, Andre's the so-called baseball player. So just because
you cannot tell me
you a little more softer and you're feel it, that don't mean I feel
Yo,
it.
Bro, chill out. You don't even know what he's talking about.
It can impact the game. You said you'll feel a little more confidence.
No. You will be more confident because your pressure is on the defense now. No, I'm speaking for a baseball player. I'm speaking for hitters.
Speak for yourself.
Bro, you don't even play baseball.
Are you speaking for everyone?
Speak for yourself.
You are out of your depth, sir.
I'm speaking for everybody who doesn't feel the way that he feels.
Speak for yourself. Stop talking for everybody else.
Nobody agrees with you. Who are you speaking for? The only person that agrees with you is next to you on screen.
People love the disadvantage of not playing at home and stuff like that. So how do you know some people don't love being down and being the reason or hitting that game-winning shot? The Michael Jordans of the world.
This is how I know you are listening. I said you will always go up to the plate.
There's a difference.
Everybody's different.
Don't conflate the two. Some people want
those moments. You can complain all day, bro.
Some people want those moments. Don't just because you
I'm just going to say take your own advice and stop speaking for everybody. Speak for yourself.
Right.
What I'm saying is that doesn't have to be what you're saying doesn't disprove that momentum isn't a thing. You just made a separate point that everyone feels a little bit differently. It doesn't mean that momentum's not a part of the game. Your point didn't make a point.
It's classic Anthony, though. It's nothing new. Because you base momentum on feelings. Everybody wanted a point, but it's rounded. Everybody doesn't have those feelings.
This is my last point because we're going in circles here, so we're gonna have to wrap
this up. You don't know that everyone has that feeling. You can't say that everyone is.
Pressure or momentum, which comes first?
They are tied.
They're tied now.
No, we've said this though.
So they're like anonymous.
This debate is losing its shape, and here's what we're gonna do.
Momentum can bring about pressure. So why does that? You're not making a point by saying that.
It was literally you're not disproving my point by saying that. It was a question.
It was a pointless question, is what I'm saying, because it didn't prove anything. Like, all I'm saying is you're trying to make points and they're rounded, they're not sharp. They're not sharp points. Like, it doesn't disprove our argument. By you making one point, and I'm not, because again, you keep talking about my argument like it's your argument. It's not the same. I said it has a part of the game. It's not the game. It's not the end all be all. It's not going to be the reason someone wins, but it can be the reason if someone wins. It's not the only reason. So listen to me when I say that, and don't come back 2 seconds later and say, oh, well, shouldn't they win everything? No, it doesn't work that way. I'm not saying that. And when you play sports, you feel it. I'm talking as an athlete. Personally, and like you were just saying before, speak for yourself. Well, you over here speaking for a lot of people, bro.
I didn't speak for anybody.
You just said you're speaking for all the people that don't agree. Stop it.
The fact that everybody doesn't feel the way that he feels.
We'll let the tape run. What I'm saying is, as a team, you can feel an impact of momentum. Some people can rise above it. I said it's a feeling. I said it's energy, bro. Stop it.
It's energy. So pressure is momentum, is what you're saying. You're equating pressure to momentum.
Like I said, momentum can cause pressure, and what very often does on the opposing teams that are not on the right side of it. What are you going to say now?
Does it mean the other team that's on the wrong side of it can't combat it and retake the momentum?
That's how you overcome adversity, and that's what all sports do. You overcome adversity. People end up with an advantage, and I'm saying momentum is a part of that. So again, your argument that it doesn't exist to me is wrong, and that's my opinion. You're both wrong.
Okay. So we're running out of time here. I wanted to get done by 2:30, but we can get done by 2.
Hit it, 2:40, Deck.
2:40 at the latest. All right, I got the last question, and it's for the Polius brothers, and I'm sure there will naturally be a rebuttal given the format of how a debate works.
I actually have to go.
All right. Well, here's my question just before you jump off. And this is for the Polius brothers. So, and Manny would like this because he mentioned it about 8 times, but this is a question. So in Super Bowl 51, 2017 and the 2016 season, when the Patriots played the Falcons and it was a 28-3 lead, was there momentum in the second half when the Patriots came out to win? If there was, let us know how and why.
Well, the Falcons obviously had the momentum going into half. You have your halftime speeches, your things of that nature. Steph, correct me
and
if
Lady
I'm wrong.
Lady Gaga as well.
But I believe the Patriots came out and scored quickly twice.
Yeah, I believe so.
So the Falcons were up 21-3 at half, and then the Falcons scored on their opening drive.
Okay,
and that was last opening drive. Yeah.
So they have all the momentum going into the third quarter. However, then after that, the Patriots retook the momentum because they scored and they kept getting stops. Hence how you have momentum pendulum swings within a game.
So are we done? You go. No, you can say a part. I want to compound on it. Julian Edelman caught that ball because of momentum, not because of his skill. I got it, bro.
All right. In all fairness,
why do you keep doing that? Like, no, seriously though, it's really annoying because it's not even good debating. It's like you're a child throwing a tantrum in a sandbox.
But that's what you guys named it for, though.
Because what you're doing is
no.
Because you're speaking a bunch of bullshit.
Watch,
because
Greg.
because you're not you're taking our point. You're taking our point and trying to make it what it isn't. Nobody said he caught the ball because of momentum specifically. That's asinine to even make that statement. All right. And I expect better from you because you are educated to make such an uneducated argument.
Hey, now, Greg.
And to say, yes, skill caused it, but the team itself, the Patriots team, because of those stops, gained the momentum and it helped them. It helped propel them. So to say, oh, he caught the ball because of momentum is stupid. Like, stop making the stupid
defense,
points, bro.
The defense got stops because of momentum. I got it, bro. You're good.
Oh, yeah, no, sorry. You just proved you don't listen.
Greg, stop. It's the same retort. It's perfectly fine. I think the listeners at home heard everything. They can make their decisions based on what we said, all right? You know, we have the opposition that said a lot of the same things and made some rounded points and not sharp ones, like I said. But I think it was – I enjoyed it. Thank you guys for coming on. I appreciate it. It was a lively debate.
Yeah. Wait, can I say one more thing? Can I say one more thing?
Andres, yeah, make your closing here. Go ahead.
I'm not going to make a closing statement.
Whatever you want to make, I don't care. Say what you got to say.
It's been a year since COVID started. Whether you think it's fake or not, you should be very grateful that you woke up today. You should be grateful that there's food on your table. You should be grateful that you have a job, if you have a job, because a lot of people got laid off. So instead of complaining and moaning about COVID being a thing, be grateful about the food on your table, having your parents at home if you have them, and give thanks to the man above for being in a household, because there's a lot of people out there that lost their home, they lost their a family member, they lost food, they lost resources. So just be grateful.
All right. Yeah. Amen for that. Andres Rivas, Anthony Mullen, thank you guys for coming on. Anthony left. I'll text him my regards if he's not listening right now. Andres, thanks for coming on, buddy.
Thanks for coming on, bro.
Appreciate it, man.
Lively debate.
Yeah, absolutely. always a pleasure.
Hey, and Declan, yes. Thank you, sir, for letting us duke it out.
You're welcome. Listen, I didn't want to be
you were a great moderator, not better than Carl.
Well, nobody's better than Carl. I don't expect you. Carl should be moderating the presidential debates. Let's just be honest. All
right, Deck, you're in your own league, man. I appreciate it. Thanks, man.
Appreciate it. All right, thanks guys.
Thanks for letting us speak.
You got it. Well, hey, like I said, I didn't want to be a replacement ref and throw some flags. So on that note, you listen to an hour and a half long special of Smoke and Mirrors here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network, presented by the Sports Hit List. I'm Declan Krogman. On behalf of Andres Rivas, Anthony Mullen, Stephen Polius, Greg Polius, we'll see you on Friday at 1 o'clock. Next time, guys. Everyone be safe. See you at the end of the week. Take care.
Have a good one. Radio Network.